This is a video for Algebra 2, Unit 10, Quadratic Modeling and Inequalities. This video is for the practice number 1 on quadratic inequalities. So the front of this paper talks about just reviewing interval notation and set notation. Right, so for number 1, you're given this number line. Now, first thing to notice is that there are closed dots. When you have closed dots on a number line, that means you're going to use the inequalities that have the equal to, less than or equal to under them. You want to notice where the endpoints are of this line segment. Well, the first endpoint is at negative 10, and the other endpoint's at negative 2. Now, when we write set notation, that means you're writing an inequality here. Okay, so our inequality, when we have two endpoints, means we're going to put the x in the middle, and we have to fill in with less than or equal to's, again, because there are closed dots. That means that from all the numbers, negative 10 to negative 2, the x values in between and including those are in that segment. All right, interval notation, because there are closed dots, you have to use square brackets on both ends of this interval. And then you just fill in the endpoints, negative 10 to negative 2. Those two statements say the same thing, they're just written in two different types of notation. All right, number 2. This time, notice that there are two parts to this number line. There are two different graphs on here. So that means when I write set notation, my inequalities, I'm going to have two inequalities. And then when I do my interval notation, I'm also going to have two intervals. Okay. On number 1, I had one number line, so I had one inequality and one interval. All right, now, for this first part, notice that the endpoint is an open dot at negative 7. So your inequality here, since the arrow is going to the left, you're going to say all those x's are less than negative 7, because going to the left, those numbers are smaller than negative 7. Now I have to put the word or here because I have two number lines. So we're trying to say the value of x is in the left ray or it's in the right ray. So the right ray, this arrow going to the right means all the numbers that are greater than 0. So x is bigger than 0. Now we just translate those into interval notation. The arrow going to the left means that it's going towards negative infinity. And that left ray is going from negative infinity all the way up to negative 7. Because I have an open dot, you have to use a parenthesis. Now this time with interval notation, instead of using the word or, we have to use the math notation union. That's the math symbol for or. Then I write my inequality for the interval for the next part. Parentheses, we start at 0, and we go all the way up to infinity. Infinity always gets a parenthesis. All right, number 3 here. Notice that number line is completely covered. That means that all real numbers are covered by that graph. So there's a couple ways we can say this. When we do set notation, you can either just write all real numbers. All right, that's totally fair. Or you can use the actual set notation, the mathematical way, is saying that the values of x are in, we use this little epsilon here, that's the math symbol for in the set of real numbers. It's a bold-faced R. Both of those mean all the real numbers you can think of. The interval notation here, well, if I look from left to right, I have arrows on the end. Those arrows go from negative infinity to infinity. So those three ways that I wrote there all mean the set of all real numbers. All right, when I look at number 4, I have one part to my number line, one part to my graph. So I'm going to have one inequality, and I'm also going to have one interval. Okay, so when I write my inequality here, I can start with the endpoints. I have an endpoint at negative 2 and another endpoint at 8. X goes in the middle, and then I have to think about the inequalities that I'm using. Because these are open dots, we're going to use the strict less than inequalities. All right, now because I'm doing interval notation and I have one interval with an open dot, I use parentheses with the negative 2 and also with the 8. All right, so that's number 1 through 4. Now with 5, 6, 7, and 8, we are going to be given an inequality, and you need to make the number line and then write interval notation that matches it. So when you're doing this here, first I have one inequality. So I'm going to have one part to my number line. I plot this negative 5 and 7 on my number line. Those are my endpoints. Because I have less than or equal to, I'm going to use closed dots for both of those endpoints. So I'm going to put a closed dot at negative 5, a closed dot at 7. X is in the middle, so I need to shade in the middle of those two dots. Then the corresponding interval notation. I have closed dots or less than or equal to symbols. Means I'm going to have a square bracket on both sides. And my interval is going from negative 5 to 7. All right, with number 6, I have two inequalities. So that means I'm going to have two parts to my number line and two intervals. I can go ahead and start, and I'm going to put open dots at negative 2 and an open dot at 3. Those are my endpoints. But you need to be able to read the inequality here. This one on the left says x is less than negative 2. So if I'm at my endpoint of negative 2, I have to draw the graph in where all the numbers are less than that. And that's to the left. The other inequality here says x is greater than 3. So that means when I start at 3, I have to shade the parts where all the numbers are bigger than 3. Finally, when I do my interval, now it's a little bit easier coming from the number line. This left interval that I'm going to draw starts with an arrow going towards negative infinity. And the interval goes all the way up to negative 2. Because there's an open dot, I put a parenthesis. Now, instead of the word or here, now there's the word or, I have to put the symbol union. That's the math or word again. And then I put my parenthesis at 3, and that interval goes up to infinity. Okay, two more here. Same kind of process. I have two inequalities, so I'm going to have two parts to my number line and two intervals. This time, because I have less than or equal to and greater than or equal to, you're going to use closed dots. You're going to have a closed dot at negative 8 and a closed dot at 0. Again, the hardest part is reading the inequality. This symbol means less than or equal to. So when you're less than, you have to shade from that endpoint to the left where the numbers are smaller. The other inequality here says x is greater than or equal to. So you're going to shade where all the numbers are greater than 0 to the right. Okay, just like the last one, when I write my intervals here, my arrow all the way at the left is going to negative infinity. And that interval goes up to negative 8. However, there's a closed dot or a less than or equal to symbol. So negative 8 gets a square bracket. The word or is replaced by the union. All right, we just talked about how this union and the or mean the same thing. 0, closed dot, gets a square bracket, and it goes to infinity. Okay, last problem on the front here. We have one inequality. So I have one part of my number line, one interval to write. I start by plotting my points negative 4 and 2, and those are going to get open dots because we have a strict less than. The x is in the middle of those two numbers, which which means that you're going to shade the middle of those two endpoints on your number line. Because I have a strict less than and open dots, you use parentheses on your interval. And your interval goes from -4 to 2. All right, so that's your review of inequalities, interval notation, and number lines. We need to apply those now on the back of your paper. This is going to be how you solve quadratic inequalities. So that means you're going to have parabolas and quadratic functions with an inequality symbol. Now, the directions say use algebraic reasoning or factoring to find the x-intercepts. Then you're going to sketch a graph of the function. That sketch just helps you figure out how to answer the inequality. Then we're going to write our answers in as inequalities, number lines, and set notation. All right, I'm going to go through the process for factoring on this first problem. I'll be a little bit more in depth here, and then the other problems I'll go a little bit faster through the factoring. So number 9, I have a trinomial here. Now, in order to factor the trinomial, we have to use the method of split the middle. One thing to remember is that the directions say we always have to make sure the inequality is compared to 0, which is happening here. We are greater than 0. This whole inequality says x squared minus 3x minus 4 is greater than 0. So we'll talk about what that means, what we're looking for, in a couple of minutes. All right, in order to split the middle here, you have to take the leading coefficient, which in this case is 1, and multiply it by the last term. 1 times negative 4 is negative 4. So you need to find two numbers that multiply to negative 4 and add to negative 3. Those two numbers are negative 4 and 1. Remember, negative 4 times 1 is negative 4, and negative 4 plus 1 is negative 3. So when we factor this by splitting the middle, the first term stays the same. The last term of the expression stays the same. And then you split the middle with these two values, minus 4x plus 1x. When you split the middle, you have to group the first two terms together and the last two terms together. And then from each group, you look for a GCF. Now, the GCF of the first group is x. And when you divide x out of both of those terms, you're left with x minus 4. The GCF of the second group is positive 1. And when you pull a positive 1 out, you're left with x minus 4. We've always talked in class that this is a really good thing to have because, look, both of these parentheses are exactly the same. So your final factored form here is x plus 1 times x minus 4. Those parentheses that were the same come down, and we write it as 1. And then you take the stuff, the GCFs that were in the front, and make them your other parentheses. All right, now that I have that factored form, we use the zero product law to find our x-intercepts. The zero product law says that you take each factor and set them equal to 0. Oops, wrote that wrong. X minus 4 equals 0. In order to find the x-intercepts, you solve for x. So here I would subtract 1 from both sides and get x equals negative 1. That's one of my x-intercepts. And then over here, I add 4 to both sides. So x equals 4 is my other x-intercept. All right. Now, we're just sketching a graph. It doesn't have to be perfect. Really, all we're interested in here is our x-intercepts, negative 1 and 4. Okay. The rest of the graph, I'm just going to sketch it. It doesn't have to look pretty. It doesn't have to go through the right points. All we want to make sure is that we know that this graph is going to open up because this leading coefficient is positive. So you can just go in and sketch a parabola that's opening up. That's good enough for me. Here's the tricky part. This is the part that is hardest for everybody. You have to know what part of the graph are we looking at. How do I solve this inequality? Well, we go back to the very beginning here. All right, I'm going to erase a little bit of stuff right here. We go back to this inequality, and it says the graph x squared minus 3x minus 4. Where is it greater than 0? Well, when we're talking about greater than 0, that means where are you above the x-axis? 0 is at the x-axis. Well, if I look at my graph here, I'm above the x-axis right here. Actually, let me do it this way. Here's my x-axis. The graph is above on these portions. But I need to figure out how to answer that inequality. How do I write these number lines and these solutions for those two blue parts that are above the x-axis? Well, here's what I like to do. And I'm just going to undo that real quick. All right, we're going to represent and say, okay, I know that I start going above on this left portion here. So that's from this x-intercept and everything to the left. That's this above part. And over here, I start at the other x-intercept, and everything that's to the right is also above. Okay, think about these. These two parts are going out. So I'm going to treat the yellow part that's on my x-axis kind of like my number line down below. So I'm going to do that first, my number line solution. I'm going to treat it just kind of like this stuff here. Right? Pretend this is a number line. Well, I have just put a dot at negative 1. Now, the kind of dot you're going to use, and I guess I should have been more careful there, is because it's greater than, you need to use an open dot at that x-intercept. And we are going to the left. So at negative 1, you're going to plot that point and go to the left. My other x-intercept at 4, well, to be greater than the axis is all the x values to the right of that x-intercept. So I start at 4, and I shade to the right. This is good because I had two parts of my graph that were highlighted here, and I have two parts to the inequality. Then it's much easier to do your set notation and your interval notation. From the front of our paper, remember the set notation is an inequality. Since I have two parts to my number line and two parts to my graph, I'm going to have two inequalities. The inequality that goes with the left is saying that all the x's, since we shaded to the left, are less than the x-intercept of negative 1. We have two parts, so we have to add the word or. Now down here, we shaded to the right. So that means we're looking at all the x's that are greater than 4. Then I just have to translate that to interval notation. Because I'm going to the left, my arrow's going towards negative infinity here, and the interval's going all the way up to negative 1. We use a parenthesis because there's an open dot. Then I use my math symbol for or, the union, and I use my four parentheses with the open dot there, to infinity. Okay, so what that's saying is that where you have x values for your parabola, anything that is less than negative 1, so if I put in x is negative 2, negative 3, negative 4, if I looked at the table on my calculator, all those y values would be bigger than 0. They would all be up here above the axis. Same thing with any number bigger than 4, 5, 6, and 7. Let's look at that now real quick. All right, when we look at our graph here, I went ahead and typed this graph into our calculator. That's the same parabola we were just working with. Now, when I look, just like I was talking about, when I look at the table here, if I investigate any of the numbers that are less then x is negative 1. Remember, we have the inequality x is less than negative 1. Notice that these y values are greater than 0. That's what we were looking for. Then we have the inequality x is greater than 4. Well, that means when I look at the x values that are bigger than 4, like 5 and 6, their y values are also bigger than 0. That's what we were looking for. Where are the answers? Where is the graph bigger than zero? All right, so that's what you're doing here when you're solving these inequalities. All right, so let's go back and let's try the next one. I'm gonna go a little bit faster with the factoring here. So I have at number 10, negative x squared plus 8x minus 15. Now when you factor, you always have to start by looking for a GCF. Here, since the first term is negative, my GCF is negative 1. So you need to divide a negative 1, out of everything on the left-hand side. When I do that, I have the quadratic negative 1 times. Well, negative x squared divided by negative 1 is positive x squared. Then we would have minus 8x plus 15. And we want to know, where is that quadratic greater than 0? So again, greater than or equal to 0 means above the x-axis or equal. And I can't spell today. I'm having a rough morning here. Above the x-axis or equal to it. So in order to factor this, we need to split the middle again. Now split the middle, we take the leading coefficient inside the parentheses, which is 1, and multiply it by the last term, 15. You need to find two numbers that multiply to 15 and add to that middle number, negative 8. Well, my two numbers are going to be negative 5 and negative 3. Negative 5 times negative 3 is positive 15, and they add together to be negative 8. Now here's my shortcut with factoring. If you notice in the first problem we did, that the two numbers we chose, negative 4 and negative 1, ended up over here being the two numbers, negative 4 and positive 1, in the factored form. That always happens when the leading coefficient of your quadratic is 1. Since I have a leading coefficient of 1, I'm going to do the same thing here. I'm going to stick the negative 1 in front, our GCF. And then factor it this way, x minus 5 times x minus 3. Now, if that trick is too much for you, go ahead and split the middle like we did in number 1. From here, I'm finding my x-intercepts. So I take each factor with an x in it and setting them equal to 0. That allows me to use the zero product law, add the 5 over, and I'll get one x-intercept of 5. And here when I add the 3, I get another x-intercept of 3 on my graph. So I'm going to sketch this graph. I'm going to put a point at 3 and a point at 5. Those are my x-intercepts. This time, I have a negative as my leading coefficient. So my graph is going to open upside down. All right, it's not a perfect sketch there, but it gives us an idea of what the shape of the parabola is. So it goes through those x-intercepts, it opens down. So this time, again, we're looking at the inequality here. We said that we're looking, where is the graph greater than or equal to 0? Again, that means if I look at my x-axis, I'll use a pen here. If I look at my x-axis here, where is the graph above that red line? Well, it looks like my graph is above the red line right in here. It's above for this curved part of the graph. Okay, so let me erase that and redo this here real quick. So I'm going to look at just the section of my graph that's in between those two x-intercepts, because those x's there have a graph that's above the axis. There is one section of that graph, so I'm going to have one inequality for my set notation, one number line, and one part to my interval. Let's do the number line first. Because I have the symbol greater than or equal to, I'm going to use closed dots. So that means I think about this as a closed dot on this x-intercept and a closed dot on the other x-intercept, and I'm shading in between them. So on my number line, I'm going to put a closed dot at 3, a closed dot at 5, and shade in between. That's easy then to translate into set and interval notation. I'm going to put my endpoints, 3 and 5, down. Since I colored in between the endpoints, the X goes in the middle. And I use my less than or equal to symbol to finish out the inequality. Again, because I had closed dots or greater than or equal to, I use brackets on my interval notation. Then I put my endpoints 3 and 5 on the interval. So this graph is higher than the x-axis or equal to it on all those x's in this green or blue line right here between 3 and 5. All right, the next part. First thing you should notice here is that there's a 2 on this side. And we want our quadratic to be compared to 0. So the very first thing you have to do before we can do anything else, you can go back to highlighter for me, is to subtract 2 from both sides. When I subtract the 2 on the right here, you end up with the quadratic x squared minus 6x plus 5 is less than 0. Now that I'm compared to 0, it's going to go really quickly and easily. In this problem, I also have a trinomial with a leading coefficient of 1. So when I split the middle here, 1 times 5 is 5. I need to find two numbers that multiply to 5 and add to negative 6. It means I'm going to need two negative numbers here. And those two negative numbers are going to be negative 5 and negative 1. Since, like the first two, I have a leading coefficient of 1, I can skip to my final factored form if I want to and get x minus 5 times x minus 1. Again, you can do the whole process of split the middle like we did in the first problem in number 9 if you need to. Now it's easy to find my x-intercepts. I take x minus 5, set it equal to 0, and take x minus 1 and set it equal to 0. Once I solve both of these equations for x, I have one x-intercept at 5 and another x-intercept at 1. Those x-intercepts allow me to sketch the graph. I'm going to put points on my graph at 1 and 5. This time, my parabola is going to open up because the leading term here is positive. So you can go ahead and sketch a parabola that opens up. All right, now we have to read our inequality carefully. Our inequality says, where's the graph x squared minus 6x plus 5? Less than 0. That means where are you below the x-axis? All right, again, we look at the x-axis here. My graph appears to be below the x-axis on this curvy part down there. So that means I'm only looking between the two x-axis here, or the two x-intercepts, I'm sorry. So let me clear that off again, then we'll make it a little bit neater. I'm looking below the graph. So I'm going to look in between those two x's here. When I look between those two x's, I'm looking at this part of the graph that is underneath. All those x's go down. All right, well, I have one part of my graph highlighted, which means I'm going to have one inequality, one number line, and one interval. Let's do the number line first. Because I'm using the strict less than, that means that my x-intercepts, my number line is going to have open dots. So I'll have an open dot at 1 and an open dot at 5. The shaded part, this green, if I treat that like the number line, is in between those two dots. So that's how I fill in my number line. Now my set notation is just like the last problem. I'm going to have one inequality with the endpoints of 1 and 5. Because in both of these I colored between the x-intercepts, I put the x in the middle. And then I'm going to use the strict less than this time to match the inequality above. The interval notation, because I have strict inequalities or open dots, uses parentheses going from 1 to 5. That's your solution. All right, very last one here. First, again, I notice that I am not compared to 0. So I need to start by moving that 14. I'm going to move it by subtracting it. Okay, I'm going to subtract 14 from both sides, just its like term. And then I'll have negative x squared plus 10x at minus 21 is less than or equal to 0. Okay, well, like two problems ago in number 10, I have a negative in front. I always have to pull that negative out in order to help me factor it. So I'm going to pull out the negative 1 here. And when I factor that, I end up having x squared minus 10x plus 21 is less than or equal to 0. Well, that negative 1 in front tells me my graph is going to open down when we sketch it in a couple minutes. But in order to sketch my graph, I need to find my x-intercepts. So I need to factor. I need to find two numbers that multiply to 21 and add to negative 10. Well, two numbers that multiply to 21, I would say, are 7 and 3, but I need to make them both negative so that they add up to negative 10. Those two values go into my factored form, x minus 7, x minus 3, and I have to put my GCF of negative 1 in front of that. That's your factored form of the quadratic. Again, you could use split the middle, use the longer version to find the factored form if need be. Now I'm going to set each of these equal to 0, each factor. And when I solve for x, I get my x-intercepts. One of those is x3, and the other guy here is that x equals 7. So 3 and 7, if I plot those on my graph right here, we'll see them. We already said that our graph has to open down because there was a negative leading coefficient. So I have a graph that's upside down, and all I have to do now is answer the question, where is my graph less than or equal to 0? When I'm less than, you're looking below again. So below this time is where I'm coloring in green. Those guys are lower than that x-axis. So I colored two parts of my graph in green right there, the two tails of my graph. So that means when I put this on the number line, I'm going to have the two outside ends of my graph colored. Again, that's just representing these two outside parts of the graph. All right, since I'm using less than or equal to, I'm going to pretend that my number line, or I'm going to draw my number line here on the graph. It's going to have closed dots, and then I'm going to go out under this blue highlighted part here. That's the graph. Those are the solutions. That's the graph of the number line that represents that. So I'm going to copy what I just drew on my axis down to my number line. I'm going to have a closed dot at 3, with an arrow that goes out to the left, and a closed dot at 7 with an arrow that goes to the right. All those values bigger than 7 are on my solution set. Because there are two parts to my highlighted parabola here, two parts to my number line, I'm also going to have two parts to the set notation. That's inequalities. The first inequality, since I colored to the left up here, are all the x's that are less than or equal to 3. I had a closed dot. I have to have the same type of symbol that I had in the original problem. Then I write the word or. And then this time on the right, all my x's are greater than or equal to 7. Finally, my interval notation also has two parts to it. Since my arrow is going to the left, it's going towards negative infinity, and that interval goes all the way up to 3. I use my math symbol for or, which is the union, and then I have a square bracket from 7 going to infinity. All right, that's your video. This is a hard topic. The hardest part is understanding what the inequalities say. You should be pretty good at finding x-intercepts. Even if you can't do it by factoring, use your calculator to help you.